Hello and welcome to this session on Asthma and FeNO, the missing piece of the jigsaw. My name is Carol Stonham. I'm a respiratory nurse based in Gloucestershire and I'm one of the southwest leads for the NHS England. I'm also the executive chair of the Primary Care Respiratory Society. So what I'd like to take you through in this section is the role that FeNO plays when we're diagnosing asthma and when we're managing patients with asthma. So where does it fit in? So I think understanding airway inflammation is vital for this. We need to go back to the BTS guidelines that tell us fairly clearly what the definition of asthma is. So as I say, it's the presence of symptoms. So we're looking for more than one symptom: wheeze, breathlessness, chest tightness, cough, and variable obstruction. But more recently, where we've looked at this airway hyperresponsiveness and really importantly, airway inflammation as main components that underlie asthma. We also talk about phenotypes and endotypes, recognizing that not all asthma is the same. We've got lots of different types of asthma. But it's this underlying stuff that is really important thing to understand. It's worth considering GINA. GINA is the global initiative for asthma. So GINA give us the guidelines on worldwide asthma, and GINA come to the same conclusion. So GINA tell us it's a heterogeneous disease characterized by airway inflammation. So really picking out that airway inflammation again. And again, it goes on to talk about the symptoms of cough, wheeze, shortness of breath, chest tightness, and it talks about that variable airway inflammation. And asthma is a very complex disease. So probably 15 years ago, asthma was considered fairly simple. We didn't know a lot of the information we know about asthma now, but asthma is really, really a complex disease. However, don't be put off by that, because what we need to understand is that we have a patient that has an underlying genetic susceptibility to asthma. They come into contact with triggers. So you can see the triggers sitting at the top there, and that may be viruses, it may be bacteria, it may be cigarettes, it may be going from warm to cold air, exercise, all sorts of allergens. And they induce this whole inflammatory cascade that sits underneath the surface of the mucous membrane. And key to that inflammatory cascade is the eosinophil, which is sitting sort of to the left at the bottom there, a nice big purpley attractive looking thing. The eosinophils are the thing that cause lots of problems with patients with asthma. We know there are other drivers like IL-4, IL-13, and those are sort of the newer treatments for asthma, but the key driver for the majority of people with asthma is the eosinophil that sits underneath the surface and is interrupted and infiltrates the area when those triggers come into play. So what happens in a patient with asthma? As I say, we have this underlying genetic predisposition that interacts with an environmental factor. So not everybody gets asthma, but people that get asthma get symptoms. That causes inflammation in the airway mucous membrane, which goes on to cause reversible airway obstruction, airway hyperresponsiveness, and the clinical symptoms the patient complains of. So the patient is unaware of everything and anything until the bottom of that whole diagram. What the patient will come in complaining of is cough, wheeze, breathlessness, those symptoms we commonly associate with asthma. I'm going to come back to this diagram shortly. So this gives a visual understanding of what's happening with asthma. I think the majority of people that look after patients with asthma will be familiar with this diagram, but if you're not, what it shows, if you took a cross-section through the airways, you would have an airway, a mucous membrane that lines the centre of the airway. And what happens in asthma is that airway inflammation, that mucous membrane becomes inflamed and angry, and it swells into the centre of the tube, causing a narrowed airspace, so less airspace for the patient to breathe in and out. The second thing that happens, and often as a result of that airway inflammation, is the muscles that lay around the outsides of the airways that are smooth muscles, so they're muscles that are you can control to a degree, because you can hold your breath and you can make yourself cough. But on the whole, they're under the control of the central nervous system, in that if you hold your breath for too long, your brain makes you breathe. And if something goes down the wrong way, you cough. And what happens in asthma is with the airway inflammation, those muscles become twitchy. They become twitchy. And when they come into contact with something they don't like, so those triggers I mentioned earlier, they go into spasm, they shut down, and they further narrow that airway. And this is a really nice visual for patients to understand, so that they can get a really clear understanding of what exactly their asthma is and what's causing the problem, and therefore where their treatments work. And again, we come back to this inflammation, this pathway that causes the problem for patients with asthma. And again, key in the center of that whole diagram, causing that whole inflammatory cascade is that eosinophil. So just remember, it's the eosinophil in about 95% of patients that have asthma that is causing the problem. Now, there's another interesting process that happens in patients with asthma. So as I say, we know the allergen hits the dendritic cell, activates the B and T lymphocytes, and then causes these inflammatory mediators, so the eosinophil, the neutrophil, the mast cell. But what the other thing we know is that then causes the symptoms the patient complains of, so the bronchospasm, the coughing, the wheeze, those types of things. But underlying that, if that's unchecked, it causes not just the acute inflammation that we associate with asthma, but persistent ongoing inflammation, which if not treated and settled, will cause remodeling of that airway. The interesting thing on the right-hand side of that diagram is what happens at the mucous membrane when all of this is active. So we all produce a little bit of nitric oxide all of the time. It's normal for us to do that as part of our respiratory processes. But we know that when the airway is inflamed and angry, and we've got the eosinophil driving that inflammation underneath the mucous membrane, there's an increase in the production of nitric oxide at the mucous membrane, which the patient then breathes out in their expired air. So if we measure that nitric oxide in the expired air, we can get a really good understanding of whether or not there is eosinophilic airway inflammation in the airway or not, linked to that result. So coming back to the diagram I showed you earlier, as I say, we've got the environmental and genetic factors that cause this airway inflammation that then goes on to cause this vicious circle of airway obstruction, of hyper-responsiveness, of the symptoms the patient complains about. We currently measure airway obstruction. So we do spirometry, we do peak flow to a degree measures obstruction, but not quite as directly. So we do spirometry routinely to measure airway obstruction. We measure our patients' clinical symptoms by using questionnaires, so things like the asthma control test. We can measure airway hyperresponsiveness by challenge testing patients, but as I said previously, that's something we would reserve probably for secondary care. But the question is, what are we doing about the things that are measurable about this airway inflammation? And I think currently we're not routinely measuring the airway inflammation, but we know we've got the tools to do that with the FeNO test. And as I've said before, FeNO is a biomarker of allergic airway inflammation. It has a direct correlation between the eosinophilic airway inflammation that underlies asthma and the amount of inflammation at the airway, at the mucous membrane. So the more the inflammation, the higher the FeNO level in the expired air. So what I really want you to take away from this is an understanding that asthma is an inflammatory condition. It is an eosinophilic airway inflammation, and we know that the eosinophilic airway inflammation increases FeNO production. If we measure FeNO production by doing a fractional exhaled nitric oxide test, we can assess the amount of eosinophilic airway inflammation the patient is presenting with. And we know, as I say, that a raised FeNO indicates the presence of eosinophilic airway inflammation. Those are your key points. So it's eosinophilic airway inflammation causing a rise in nitric oxide production that we can easily measure. I hope that was helpful. That's one of a series, so please do join us for the others. Thank you for watching.